Greetings, journeyers. I'm Maris Christian Burcha. In this episode, we have a very special guest, the electronic music innovator and ambient pioneer Steve Roach. He is a versatile and prolific musician whose vast output is revered by many for its spiritual depth and visionary beauty. He is also the first American composer introduced to our audience. It was in 1994 when we presented two of his tribal-ambient masterpieces, Dreamtime Return and Artifacts. Ever since then, he's been a favorite artist on Journeys to the Infinite, and now, after 26 years, it's a great pleasure to have him on our podcast. Steve, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much. Glad to be here.
A few weeks ago, you celebrated your 65th birthday. How do you feel about this stage of your life?
Yeah, that's complex, but the short answer is never felt more empowered in my music and in life. And, you know, the Bloom Ascension is really relates that title of one of my more recent albums, I guess, is the best way to describe what I'm feeling. It's that the blooming of everything that I've put so much of my life and passion and desire into is just seems to be really, you know, unfolding at another level at this point at 65, which is a number that represents time here, but in terms of having any kind of limitations on that besides when we'll be checking out, you know, with the final check out there. But in the meantime, just never felt better, felt really inspired and health-wise doing great. It's all just an exciting time in my life. And like you just said before we went on live here, that 20 years ago, you know, your thoughts of speaking with me was
unimaginable.
Yeah. So for me to think back and thinking of this person at 65 years old, what's that going to be like? Well, it's the same as 25 or 35 or 45 or 55 or 65. Somehow the music and my passion for that, it just runs in my veins in a way that just feels like it keeps me healthy and focused. And it's not a word that even happy can describe. It's just a feeling of really being completely nourished by, you know, what happens every day up till 4 minutes ago when I faded the board down to call you here. So yes, 65 and thriving, feeling great.
Glad to hear that.
Thank you.
Returning to your beginnings, when was the moment you discovered your fascination with music? Do you still remember that moment?
Yes, I do. I remember the moment probably with sound, the sensation of hearing and hearing sound as something that was beyond music, but sound that was something that really felt so nourishing. And that sound awareness really was, I would say, awakened out in the desert areas outside of where I grew up in Southern California. That kind of sense that it would bring me through sound, which was really at the threshold of silence as well. It would be where the silence would be so powerful in those desert areas where I would go camping and over long weekends with my parents. That sense, just somehow I was so ready for that, so already aware of it as a young person. So when I heard that and had that experience, it seeded something that was about activating that space in other ways that I would discover later. But the initial seeding of that sound awareness of what grows out of silence and out of a natural relationship to sound in those deserts, that kind of that threshold that you can reach where you hear the sound of your body, really, it's so quiet. Mm-hmm. That would be perhaps maybe the first drone music that I created, was just with the awareness of my own body creating that. So from that place forward, it certainly was activated through early listening to progressive music and instrumental music that had passages of those qualities in there, and then eventually discovering particularly the music of Klaus Schulze and Time Wind, and those early classic albums were the ones that just completely confirmed and validated and inspired and shone a big light upon this whole world that, you know, I would enter into and, you know, create from.
Yeah. You've met Klaus Schulze, I think, at the beginning of the 90s.
That's correct.
There is a picture with both of you. For me, that image have historical value. Do you remember what did you talk then?
Right. So that was right after my concert at Klimdag in Netherlands. And meeting Klaus at that moment and being in Europe for my first tour, and all of that was, you can imagine, a lot to hold. But at that moment, I can still feel the sense of, this is just feels so right. You know, it was relaxed. And of course, I was in great respect and honored to meet Klaus. And I remember the conversation started directly about performing for audiences around the world and how he was responding to the audience in Netherlands, how they were just so supportive and could just pretty much go in any direction you wanted and they'll be there with you. And I was agreeing with that because at that time, I'd also was, you know, introducing the didgeridoo into my music, which was also a new piece at that point. And So all of that made sense to me. And I was just presenting the music that I had to present at that moment. And of course, adding a didge in there with all the electronic was different and the more tribal aspects of what I was doing. But we were talking about those aspects and performing live, and Michael Shreve, who we, you know, had worked with, and we spoke about that for a bit. And yeah, that was a moment, certainly a moment that lives on, because I still have the letter that I wrote Klaus in the early days, basically, as I was just getting, you know, everything into focus, and wrote Klaus a long letter, and then he wrote me back, and, you know, I still have it in a drawer in here, and that's a piece of my own personal history where he listed out I had an ARP 2600 and string ensemble and sequencers, and he was writing his approval on all that, you know, in a fun way. And then he asked me if I had an echo machine and a few things like that. So that was in the probably 10 years earlier that or more that that letter had come in. So it was a moment in time there that I love.
Yeah, and this Berlin School influence is part of your musical DNA. After your tribal ambient phase, which was an important innovation moment, in the recent years you have returned to your electronic roots, especially to sequencers. What appeals to you most about working with analog sequencers?
Yeah, absolutely. That music, as I suggested on the Skeleton Keys album, it just, since the dawn of my musical time in hearing Time Wind and the early Tangerine Dream and the music that was propelled through sequencer-based forms, there's just a place that we all access through that music that you just don't get it in any other way. There's no other way to access parts of your consciousness and awareness and body sensation, everything. The whole feeling of what music brings to you and the kind of the intensity of turning the volume up on life itself, to me, is sequencer music. You turn it up, you know, to 11 with sequencer music. It's just, it has something about it that's so intrinsic to consciousness and to awareness and to playing with time and the layers of time that you can interact with. Through that, again, it's a place that you access and enter into that's beyond the fascination of the technology, but it's the end result. It's the place that you arrive in your awareness, in your consciousness, that that music activates. And it's forever giving you that feeling. It's not a nostalgic piece. It's a function, a music that has function in terms of its what it provides and creates for you. So the tribal music grew out of my love of sequencer music, but at that time, I clearly was aware of taking the tonality away from the patterns and from the rhythms and putting it more into a tuned percussive world, to where the melodic aspects of it were not so obvious. It was more polyrhythmic and more, you know, non-traditional or Western based in terms of notes and scales and melodies. Those were there in the tribal forms, but in a way that would bring your focus to other things that were happening around in the composition or in the pieces and the music and the landscape of sound, rather than where sequencer music itself is the interweave of all those patterns or what it's about and how those, the harmonics and the structures and the time divisions and all of that combine to, you know, to create that skeleton key, that particular key that opens a door that's the only way you get into that place through that style. So the fact that I could eventually bring a large format modular into my studio, it's become quite affordable. And so in 2014, I built that system up. I'd already been working with Eurorack for years, since the 90s, when it was first imported, the only stuff, the only game in town was Dopefer at that time in the mid to late 90s. So I was working with that, but the form of the larger format modular is really what, you know, blew the doors open for creating all the music that you've heard recently in the last, well, since 2014, that whole series of releases that go into that place.
Speaking of studios, I've noticed that initially you worked in Time Room Studio and now is Time House. Is Time House a new place, or is the same as Time Room but larger?
Yes, well, Time Room is, you know, in certain respects, it's an evolving, traveling, where I end up over time is where the Time Room is. And I've, since the early Time Room in San Diego, there must have had, half a dozen locations that would qualify as Time Rooms. But now, in south of Tucson, where I live, I'm not very far from the border in Mexico. I'm up, you know, on a high ridge top here with a house that's just the entire house is studios in all the rooms. So that's the Time House. I have the main studio and set up with all of the many of the instruments that I've had since for years, and I've had my original Oberheims and other instruments that I've never left from. I've been working with those through it all, through the trends of a lot of people selling all their analog off. Well, that never happened for me. That's the sound, the core of my whole process. So in any case, I have a live room and then the main room and then what I call the analog cave. So all three of those rooms are up and running all the time. So I can move between those three spaces and work on music that constantly of different forms of music. And might be one room might have a long form immersive piece that's being created over a period of time, and I can keep it up and alive and, you know, it running through the board. So much of, well, everything I do is on hardware equipment. I use zero soft synths, and so everything is connected to the instruments and my flow and the way that I work with, you know, I have a 56 channel mixing console, so everything's being mixed through the board, performed through the board with effects, external effects and all of that. So my process that started so many years ago has continued to evolve but stay consistent with how I love to work, which is hands-on hardware, that kind of interface where you're living and breathing with the instruments. And all those three rooms, sometimes they coalesce together, and I might have something running in the main room that somehow is starting to influence what's going on in the other room. So it's a really powerful and fun way to have all these layers and going on. So in that way, it's really like a painter where you have, you know, different paintings evolving and on different easels and moving between them all. So it feeds each other.
I understand. Also, you gave many, many concerts. Some of them are recorded and released, as is the case with your latest album, The Sky Opens. What is for you the main difference between studio recording and live performances?
Well, of course, with live, it's all building towards a moment in time and how you prepare for that moment. Well, that's intense. The amount of time and energy that I focus into a set and building this experience to go out live with is way more involved and complex, I think, than a lot of people might think about that it takes to go into that. And so through that process of preparing for live, a lot of material music gets recorded during that process because of what you're doing there in terms of bringing all your dreams and aspirations and forms into a set that, for me, it has to have a roadmap. There has to be a story that's told, you know, this journey that's being laid out. So through that process, that's also one of the side gifts of playing live is how much music starts to emerge out of that because of, well, there's that moment in time and there's a certain amount of, I would say, well, you just can't escape when there's a date and a place and a time and you have to be there with, you know, all of your tools, which is pretty vast with me playing all hardware equipment live. There's different waves you go through of exhilaration and excitement and then like, oh my God, well, you know, what did I get into? Here we go again. You know, you've got that piece going on just because of the level of complexity and then travel and all that stuff. So it all adds up to just prioritizing and putting you in a place where it's, you know, like, why do people climb Mount Everest? Sometimes you think, what drives a man to do that or a woman to do that? There's certain points where it's really uncomfortable, but then once you break through those points, then That's where the real stuff happens that just tells you why you're doing it. You know, the music that emerges from that kind of putting yourself out on the line like that, and then the process of actually outdoing it. Well, that, for example, in that large, beautiful cathedral space, the sound and the experience of playing my music in such a place and in the places I've played, you know, all over the world that are unique and different, that feeds the music in a way also that you absolutely never can get close to in the safety of your studio, where everything's completely controlled and you can take breaks as you need to, you can linger on, you can just shut it down, which I usually never do anyway. But in terms of just having a moment in time where, you know, it's that Kairos moment, it's the meaning of time and destiny, that's what a concert is to me. And so it's like physical engagement. If you stay healthy and you have an exercise program and you eat right, you get stronger and healthier and more focused and potentially, hopefully. And so for me, doing the music live has always been since day one. I mean, the first 6 months after somehow getting the essential tools that I wrote Klaus Schulze about that I had bought from studying the back of Moondawn with the TARP 2600 and the string machine and that kind of thing, that experience from playing live just takes everything and builds this kind of strength and this kind of hyper awareness of how to bring through these experiences, you know, more with agility and with focus and with a willfulness to step out and into the unknown and trust that. And then that's what you're hearing on so much of this music. At the same time, The Sky Opens is, I mean, that's a very, you know, very specific set, but within all of those pieces there's vast amount of places and spaces to explore and experience differently every time I play it. So it's not playing pieces back in some kind of fashion to where you had a really wonderful hike yesterday as a metaphor and you want to go out and take that hike again, so you're going to be preoccupied by trying to find exactly where you walked by stepping in your footsteps from yesterday. That's absolutely not what I'm talking about here. It's about having a structure and a framework that lets you completely explore and expand the parameters, which can melt away where you're in completely new places. And maybe I'm playing a piece from Dreamtime Return, but never before like the way it's being experienced tonight. Yeah. So that's always, you know, a wonderful challenge there too.
Indeed. You received two consecutive Grammy nominations for the albums Spiral Revelations and Molecules of Motion. It was a remarkable surprise and a well-deserved recognition of your impressive artistic accomplishments. What are your thoughts on these Grammy nominations?
Well, if it was asked 3 or 4 years ago, I would have no thoughts at all and would think that what, why, and how would that ever happen? I mean, it was absolutely not on my radar and never thought about Grammys more than how I'm not going to watch it on TV this weekend, for example, you know?
Yeah.
So it was not on my radar, and that was it. How it all happens is someone at originally, if Hearts of Space or Fortuna or Celestial Harmonies or Project, if any of those labels through my whole career had, like say when Dreamtime came out, they could have submitted that to the Recording Academy for the potential to be voted in, you know, during the same year as Peter Gabriel's Passion album, for example. So what it says there is that labels all along just really didn't think about it either. They could have, I suppose. I mean, Hearts of Space, they were probably more into playing that game than other labels in terms of public profile. In any case, we've fast forward to, you know, 2 years ago or whenever the Spiral Revelation was, 17 or 18. The whole story is I just woke up on another morning and getting ready to go and studio fired up and checking emails, and all of a sudden calls and emails are all coming in with congratulations, and I'm just immediately like, for what? And then I say, well, obviously, you know, you must be thinking about another Steve somebody or something, you know. I just really thought it was not a joke, but
yeah, a confusion.
Yeah. And in any case, then Howard Givens called me, you know, the owner of Spotted Peccary, and he said, so what do you think about that? And I said, what do you know about it? And so Howard was actually the person that started the whole fall of the dominoes, so to speak. That year, they did not have a release they have been submitting albums from their label. They are aware of how that profile can help gain visibility for the music. So at that point, he was mastering my albums, and I've known Howard for 30 years, it seems like now, for so long. He's a dear, dear friend and a confidant. Mm-hmm. And so he submitted the album quietly. He did not say to me that he did, or to Project Sam Rosenthal. He just submitted the album, and then that was it. From that point till the announcement came, it was all just in behind the scenes doing its Grammy thing. And then eventually I was brought into to that fold, and it was surreal. I mean, it was really like you're working in the studio and something falls out of the sky through the roof of the house, you know, right onto the mixing board. And yeah, it's like, oh my, really? I mean, okay, well, so, you know, that whole first experience was fascinating because I saw how much weight over here and maybe in Europe that word carries. You know, it was a game changer in many ways, in terms of just a lot of people that I interface with out in the world who know that I do music, but they really do not know what kind of music. That just everyday kind of folks that you run into, this and that, people at the bank or whatever, and then all of a sudden then they see that, and then it changes how they see you and how they, which is
a change of perception.
Yeah, it's a perception and a some other kind of thing that happens where nothing really changes from one day to the next, except around you people acknowledge that you've been called out, you know, in a good way, for something that they recognize as a word that means some kind of accomplishment. So, you know, all of that, I didn't have any real hard time integrating it or reconciling it. I just thought, well, that's another cool turn in the road here. And if it means more people will be brought to what I've been doing my whole life, then bring it on. You know, that's what you want, is to reach people mm-hmm. that have interest or might, you know, want to dive into this world that I've already been creating for 35 years or something. So that was cool. You know, I could see comments here and there about, well, should have got one 20 years ago, or who cares about that, and all that stuff. But I really wasn't cynical about it or ungrateful. And at the same time, I just, anything that's not directly feeding the music, I just ground it and then just keep focused on what I do every day when I wake up, is get right into the studio and, you know, go to that place. So then a year later, Project got on board. Well, after the first Grammy, that they joined the Academy and they submitted Molecules, just because, well, why not, you know? And to me, it was even more surreal to wake up that morning and actually go, because I knew that the results were coming in on that particular day, and I went to the page and scrolled down and looked at it, and I was there again. And that was surreal. That was like, how can lightning strike twice here, you know? So the first year I did not go to the ceremony because it was in New York City and I had concerts, and it was probably snowing in New York City, and all of those combinations added up to where I would just rather, you know, I mean, I already was on the program for concerts and all of that. So then this year, or last year, when it was last year, that was in LA. It was great because going to LA, I've spent 12 years there, so I have some deep history there, and that was really an emotional, wonderful feeling to be going back to LA with that experience and have that kind of perspective on worth, like a marker in time. And then at that weekend, that was the weekend I went and surveyed the ambient church site, you know, the church that I would be playing at several months later. So it was all perfect in that way.
Regarding labels, Project Records is your primary label since 1995, but also you published on your own label, Time Room Editions. How do you choose between these two labels when releasing a new album?
Yeah, that's a fascinating question. Well, for example, Sky Opens was more or less heading towards Time Room because of the frequency of the releases with Project, and it felt like also a live album and a double album. It just felt like that was something I would focus on for my label. It's just, there's just a feeling around each album about, and the timing of when something previously came out on Project. It's really based on a feeling, and then I'll check in with Sam Rosenthal, the owner of Project, and we'll have a meeting about that, and then we look at what's also coming down the road for releases after this album. And because I'm always working on multiple projects and currently have releases planned, you know, through the rest of the year already, the Project release schedule can be full to the point to where he can't take on another album. But I have albums that I release originally through my Bandcamp page, like Invisible or This Place to Be, and then the interest for the CD is still there, so I'll put those out myself on Time Room as a limited edition, for example, which is what I'm doing now with the Still Point release that came out on the Solstice in December, and that double album's at the factory right now, and there was, you know, such a great response to the music and requests for the CD. So it's really very organic, and it goes release by release, and it also is related to perhaps the style of music that I'm working in at that point, and what just came out on project. And, you know, we want to have contrast, and we want to have different perspectives coming through project, and because of also their ability to put it out into different places, for, you know, which I do the same with Time Room, but it's a bit more relaxed in terms of the level of promotion that goes into that.
Yeah. Also, I got to ask you, last September you have reunited with Michael Stearns in his Santa Fe studio. Your last recording together was 25 years ago on the album Kiva. Do you plan a new collaboration album?
Well, that's what started that session that weekend, and we were both on a very large orbit that's not synchronized up with each other, but we, you know, connect in every few years, and we're still connected through our history and through all the experiences we had in Los Angeles, and then eventually Kiva was recorded when he first moved from LA to Santa Fe. I've been playing concerts in Santa Fe in the summer for the last few years, so this year he was in town, and it just felt absolutely obvious and clear that I needed to check in with Michael in his hometown, and I invited him to come in and play in the set with me, and he brought the Beam, you know, that magnificent 12-foot long
instrument,
super bass instrument. So we had a wonderful concert that evening and just reconnected, and then it just became real easy and clear that after that weekend of concerts, I would go over to his place and stay for a few days, and we would just go into the studio and start seeing what happens. So that's where it's at now. We're both so busy that we haven't really had time to circle back around on that. I know we will, but in terms of timeline and when and whatnot, it's nothing I'm hiding out from that answer, but there's just nothing clear right now with that. But it can happen quickly, and probably will at the right time.
Yes, we will wait patiently for this.
Yes.
Your music have an experiential quality and a healing value. Your work is a quiet, spiritual manifesto and a medicinal tool in the same time. Do you intentionally compose music as a way toward deeper states of consciousness?
I would absolutely, the short answer is yes. And that grows from and exists because of my own need to have that experience constantly. It's not manufactured as a product or something that I need to feel like I'm creating to put out in a marketplace. It's something that is absolutely a necessity in my own nervous system, in my own being, to create this music that you hear. So there's a quality in it that's self-healing and generating of energy and activating of emotional states. So all of that comes from my own being, my own desire to, it's almost like completing a circuit or creating a kind of sonic experience that gives me a sense of wholeness and being connected into whatever, however you want to define this feeling is of being alive. You know, what is the energy of being alive? What is that process that's so impossible to put words to, and we all try to put music and art and words and visual art and all of that. It's some frequency of connecting to life and how you perceive that. Could be, you know, a very dark vision of that. It could be a combination of wanting a pure state of eternal expanded sense of connection to eternity, which I have a lot of in my music, where I just want to feel this expansion and this continuous state of no boundaries and no limits within the feeling of sound and your own connection to that. So there's just an endless source of desire and inspiration to draw from every day. It would be like getting up one day and saying, well, I think I'll stop breathing today because I've had enough of that, you know. So it can't happen. I mean, music and breathing and inhaling, you know, and being inspired means to breathe in, to draw in. And so I feel that level of inspiration that is just constantly there to draw from. And especially as this whole world of sound as an art form, and how the whole Eurorack synthesizer, the tools of creating this music has completely blown up massive, and how, I mean, you can just about buy Eurorack modules at the corner store now, you know, it's the market. Mm-hmm. It's so popular and so commonplace. And so that's really so wonderful, you know, so exciting and so powerful that alongside all the crazy stuff that's going on the planet, that you have that current of positivity and inspiration and all of those tools to, you know, pushing beyond the safety of limitations of what's around us.
Yeah. Before ending our conversation, one more thing I'm curious about. Somehow you created your own genre and you're one of the greatest ambient acts of all time. Do you ever think of your legacy?
Well, I appreciate you sharing those thoughts. I mean, it's when I hear that at this moment, the part that it brings up is the part I spoke about infinity, where I have no desire to be checking out. You know, I want to be here creating in 50 years, in 100 years. You know, I just somehow want to I don't want to leave the planet. So that's the part that gets, at 65, you know, well, there's a lot of years behind me and there's a lot of years in front of me if I can help it. That's why that's the most surreal part, is that the energy and passion and focus that I have from 30 years ago is just times 100 since then. And so that in itself is just the biggest gift of all that I can keep drawing from for myself and for those that love what I do. The legacy, well, I mean, the body of work that's here, that, you know, that'll be there in 200 years, it's already doing its thing. The big piece right now is that I have so much unreleased material. It would be shocking for people to see how much music is here that's never been released. You could line it up from here to the moon maybe two times, all the CDRs and all the tapes. I mean, it's crazy. I mean, it's so overwhelming because I'm recording all the time. And so part of my response to that is I created my exclusive page at Bandcamp, which is basically not exclusive to anybody. It's just a subscription. It's like if you subscribe for a small amount of money a month, then you get each month new unreleased material. It's really the only way I can keep that flow of music out and also not cause Sam at Project to have a nervous breakdown because I'm releasing five albums in a month or something. You know? So it's a solution, and it's a good solution because I've got a really great core of subscribers, just like you would with a magazine or whatever people subscribe to. For the cost of, you know, two coffees a month, you get like this amazing material. So that's really part of what is, you know, I'm very active, proactive now, like looking at how to get a lot of this music, you know, a lot of it's live material, well, studio versions of different mixes or unreleased long form spaces where I'm creating spaces that I might have recorded 5 or 6 hours of something that could be, you know, I can have immersion 12 out by now with what these are. You know, if the listeners are interested in checking that out, it's at Bandcamp and it's a Steve Roach exclusive page. And it's a very cool place to dive into the deep catalog, non-catalog titles, you know, just over time. I've got some really, really cool stuff that's going to be coming through there. So that'll be out there and forever.
Steve, thank you for all your amazing work. It was a great honor and pleasure speaking with you.
Marius, thank you so much. I'm glad we finally could circle back around and be here. And I'm just absolutely grateful for your audience and for you to experience our conversation today. Thank you.